what do you call that thing when people take a caveat or something, as you were saying earlier? Anything that comes out of these guys' mouths was not sponsored by me. It's everyone's personal opinion. Hi. Okay. But this is where my head at, and this is why I want you guys. First off, you, because it's so evident in your music, the last, like, Clone Wars, that it's important to start talking about political change and the way that things are happening in this country, what it is that people are going through, people are suffering, whether our leaders are actually aware of all that kind of stuff. And I don't want it to be like, we'll talk about things that are happening or things that have been done, like, in our government, but most importantly is that if it's looking at this concept of, if this isn't the right idea, what is the right idea? What do we need to be doing? What needs to change in the structure of Nigeria to actually get leadership working for its people?
I think where we're at right now is first to accept that, like, you know, we're currently operating in, for all intents and purposes, a failing nation, failing on so many different levels, but mostly failing, like, the citizens of the nation, because the very basic things like healthcare, education, electricity, all those things are things that, like, you know, they're not even getting better. We're not looking at the position that, okay, we're close to the promised land. Like, it seems like we're straying further away. And that's just on a basic level. Then also failing in the sense that, like, for the everyday man on the street, things are getting more difficult, like, things, it's harder to get money to feed yourself, feed your family, raise your family. And what that does, there's a song on our album, Palmoil Music 2, called The Garden. And what we're trying to talk about in that is that, like, if you leave a garden untended for a very long time, it sort of becomes a jungle. And now we've left the garden, not even untended, but I almost feel we're at the point where we're kind of deliberately sabotaging the garden and expecting people to come out sane. So the animals in the garden, or and in that analogy, the people are getting wilder. They're getting, you know, they're getting more, you know, more desperate, you know, and that's just a byproduct of this failed leadership, and it's not just failed leadership in terms of just the vacuum of the last 10 years, like, failed leadership for as long as I can remember. Yeah. I've never lived in a country where I can say this leader actually cared about, like, he's a populist leader who cares about the people. I've yet to see that. Yeah. You know, so.
Well, to be honest, I have to start off by saying there's a few governors out here who have surrounded themselves with young people and are looking, and to me, seem as if they're taking steps in the right direction. They're focused on IGR, which is very important. And this, without going too deeply into economics, IGR for Nigeria is one of the most important things. Now, for me personally, I've lost faith in the government. I believe it's up to us, you know, the private sector. Yeah. When the recession hits, how many years ago it was, you know, the private sector, more importantly, creative arts and us, more or less pulled Nigeria out of this recession. Anybody can take the credit for it, but the amount of industry shown in Nigeria by us, the young people, is incredible. So without the government, we've been forced to find our ways to survive. There's no jobs. We're not even looking for jobs. Who do you, if it's not the government, you're going to start your own business or do your own thing. That's a very sad situation, you know? I believe it's up to us. The government cannot do or does not do anything for us, because the truth of the matter is that the situation in Nigeria is not that hard to fix. There's so many countries who have had much less than us who have made it out of nothing. Singapore, but more obviously Dubai.
We've borrowed money from us.
It is ridiculous. And the worst part about it is that the kind of corruption that goes on in Nigeria is not even, it's flagrant, it doesn't even make sense to me. Because you'd make more money by giving yourself
actually benefits.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Generational wealth. Legacy.
It's lacking, people don't do it, people don't, I was talking about this earlier.
Why is that?
But we've been, like you said, I think one of the things that we're set up to fail. This is the fact that we have to understand that we haven't
by who
grasped that, by the British. When we were colonized, we were set up to fail.
Well, what's changed?
But sorry, can I just jump in? Two things. I feel like there is, I feel like, to be very honest with you, most colonized countries were set up to fail. And even within that context of most colonized countries being set up to fail, some of them have experienced other things like genocide and wars. Especially, I'm talking about African countries primarily. Yeah, but then at the same time, a lot of those countries are beginning to, even within the restrictions of the failure that they've been set, the way the game has been rigged, a lot of them are beginning to sprout up. Yeah. And that's because there's a clear, concerted effort to move forward.
Yeah.
If you go to Rwanda now, it's different. Exactly what I was, it's different, about. Like 20 years from a genocide.
There's no but Tutsi, then there's no a, Tutsi anymore.
Yeah, yeah, there's a collective
and so
effort.
So that's the thing. My point is that one of our issues is we were set up to set up to fail,
mm-hmm.
but we have not stepped out of that exactly. culture mindset. You can still speak to people today, as much as they're demanding or want better for their country, mm-hmm. will still argue by tribal lines.
Mm-hmm. This is why I said it's two prompt. Issues.
But then, so let me just. I think that like that's why, very early on, I said the. I feel like the government or the system here is set up to deliberately sabotage the garden, which is Nigeria, because they operate on tribal and religious lines for their campaigning, for their elections, for everything. They are pushing that agenda directly. So it can't be like if you look at any country in the world, if you go to America, for example, the kids at school, they're taught the pledge, yeah. they're indoctrinated from a very early age to love their country. America's the greatest, like we go around the world and do, and they paint a very clear picture to their kids. So these things are policy. Like anybody look at, just take one single aspect, like Lagos is filthy. And that's because it's a concerted effort to push recycling or to push clean, but we're not even thinking of how we're going to, I feel like deliberately, like our government and the people in power are actually playing on all these things.
Yeah, of course they are.
I don't even want to talk about the negative parts. I want to focus on the solution.
On exactly the solution. Yeah. So what is it that we start to do? Because I've had...
First of all, I want Nigerians, the young, us, the highest demographic, 70%, we're already doing the right thing, but we need to encourage each other. We need to start proper industries and take the power back. We need to control the media. We need to control the banks. We need to have our own lending facilities and support each other across tribal lines. Because the truth of the matter is, I am not a tribalist. No matter what my people or where I'm from, how they feel, at my age being educated, and I find that most people in Nigeria are not actually, the young people are not actually like that one-on-one. I have friends that cut across everything, and I don't know if it's just the demographic that I'm from, because I cannot honestly speak for the whole of Nigeria.
And that's the issue. I think that's one of the issues, because we talk and we have a certain level of education and opportunity that we've been afforded. Mm-hmm. But now what about the people who are so limited in their exposure?
Because they're not that limited anymore.
No, but there are a lot of people that are.
No, but the young people, are they really?
I think we still think. They don't have access. They have access to things. But if you think about it, if you go around this country, right, like you'll be surprised at the amount of, in my opinion, suffering that people are going through. So people are literally just trying to figure out how to get the next meal, how to continue to keep hustling. You know, so and when that is your mindset, you can't start thinking beyond your immediate needs, because your immediate needs are so pressing that you have to focus on them.
Access to even solve those immediate needs.
Yeah.
So limited.
So what are the solutions? First of all, people that have these ideas mm-hmm. need to get into government.
Yeah. But then, you know, we've come on the way, how do we get into government?
Yeah.
How do we get into government en masse where there's a level of unity that can be influential? Because if you get there one at a time, you're not really going to have, you can't mm-hmm. penetrate. Mm-hmm. So how do we start to get into position government? Especially because the focus of us are between Abuja, Lagos, PH, all those kind of places. How do we cut to wider spaces? Because if you're going to have real influence in Nigeria, then you need seats in National Assembly that cut across mm-hmm. Other states and not just the major states, but people aren't going to the other states. We're all focusing ourselves on coming to where the limited access to money seems to be.
I think
I'm going to be honest with you. I don't feel like, you know, that's, you know, that a direct approach would work, because we've seen this in the last elections. We know what goes on in elections. There's no need for us to waste our time.
Yeah.
Everybody knows the real power is the money. So, like I said, we must focus on this private sector, develop our own personal industries, develop our own exports, which do not have to be material, it could be services, which we already do. Nigeria leads the world in the biggest, what's it called? Yeah. Brain drain.
We're running to Canada right now.
Yeah. Everybody's out.
I find that the biggest corruption in Nigeria is the corruption of the mind. A lot of people are willing to sacrifice principles and morals at the drop of a hat. And that's from the older generation to right now.
Yeah.
You know, so even in the collective thing that you're saying, I feel that, like, even that, to me, it can work, because there's people coming together to try and think of how to create their own form of power in a non-conducive environment, actually, because every business, you want to start industries, you have no light, you have no, like, so all those things already.
I would make if I didn't have to spend money on diesel.
Exactly, but you do, and you're probably going to have to for the next 30 years.
Because you talked about this thing in terms of how quickly people will let go of any level of morals and all of that. Because one of my issues becomes, you can come together as a collective and say, these are the values we're standing by, these are the things we're saying we want to achieve.
Mm-hmm.
Now, the moment you leave that collective, can you trust that everybody's going to stick to those values that you've created for yourself? And these things, I believe, have been negatively influenced by the strangle on things, like on opportunity and all these kind of things, because the money that we have access to is not, it doesn't compete.
The truth of the matter is, like I said before, you would make more money if you did things properly. That's the truth. Even for your greedy individual agenda, for you, and you would make more money.
Without
cursing anybody out, they are not, they have shown us from the past that they are not intelligent enough to even do the corruption properly. It's ridiculous. You know, they're sending Yahoo boys to prison for years. I don't support Yahoo in any way, you know, the fraud. But look at what the past governments that we've known about, which will always get exposed after they leave, have done. You're talking about walking out of the treasury with billions of dollars.
So, this like thing, they're not smart enough.
You know, it's then. But they
haven't been challenged to the point where they need to be smart enough. No, but what is going?
Yeah, look, they get away with it because of the corruption. But the problem, the truth of the matter is that we need to educate them on how to be corrupt better.
I don't think that's the answer.
No, it's not the answer. Obviously not. I'm being sarcastic, but you know what I'm trying to say.
Yeah, no, but I think this, right?
We have to get into government. That's the only thing.
But the truth of the matter is this, right? Like, I'm not against the idea of people getting into government. In fact, people, whilst I'm not political, I will always support people I know that want to try and get into government, whatever little way I can or whatever resources I have available, right? Like, because for me, I feel like the more people that get in there, and at the same time as well, I don't even, to be very honest, I've reached the point where, like, even when they do get in there, my hopes are not high, but at least it's one start, like, because you could get in and get compromised as well. The truth is that there's an analogy where it's like, if you put like rotten fruit next to a good fruit in a refrigerator, the good fruit will get rotten quicker. So there's no way you're going to, like, you know what, I'm going to be the one shining light in this mass of, like, you know, and
no,
so.
But there's a lot more money to be made.
But for me, I think that the first thing, first and foremost, what if I was ever getting involved in the political system, and by that I mean just voting, right? I feel that it is impossible to keep repeating the same mistakes and bringing the same people that have clearly had nothing to offer.
One of the biggest issues I've had generally when it comes to structures and leadership is no one has a vision that succeeds even their time in office. No one is aiming at what they think Nigeria should look like in 20, 30 years.
Mm-hmm.
Because you cannot always be dealing with today's problem and not have your eye on tomorrow's problems.
Mm.
And so we need to get to a place where we start to think more of others, which is why I say investing in other people in terms of education, opportunities.
Mm-hmm.
We wiped out our middle class effectively decades ago.
Mm-hmm.
And while you do that, you think that you're creating opportunities. Why do most people, most businesses fail at second generation? Mm-hmm. Because once you have the person who started something leaves the space, no one is invested enough in that same opportunity or that same business. Yeah. It's the same thing we see in our governance when after someone else comes to them, they shut down everything the other person was doing before just to do something to create their own personal legacy. Mm-hmm. And so we need to start thinking more about the greater good, creating opportunities for people and rebuilding our middle class. A country without a middle class is hopeless.
Yeah. I also think to add to that, I feel like one of the things in every field, and it's not just like I'm in the entertainment industry, but one of the things I find is that like there's no capacity development, and I feel that that's crucial in the sense that like I work both in film and in music, right? And so for me, I work with a lot of people who do different things, camera guys, sound guys, different things. Majority of the people that like actually have these skills, funny enough, were most of their skills were developed in the church because that's places where they have access to camera equipment and to sound, and to most of the musicians and producers that I work with got their start in the church as well because that's where they have access to these things. So for me, it's okay, how do I then, just in my own little world, how do I then create opportunities? And I feel that that's where what Femi was talking about. Okay, I've been around the world. I've been able to meet people, not just that are artists, but people that want to come and do training or workshops or whatever. So now how do I facilitate some of those things? So they come to Nigeria, they train. And I feel that it's not just in music, like I feel the world has gone to a place where people are doing augmented reality. People are doing crazy things on computers. We're still in, when I was doing NYSC, I decided, okay, I really want to go and teach. So I'm going to go to a school and I'm going to teach. And they said, what's your background? I said, I did IT for my first degree. And they were like, okay, so we're going to put you in like the computer, you're going to teach computer science. Mm-hmm. And I remember going to a school and we get there and they literally gave me like a cardboard cutout. And it was a cardboard cutout of a monitor. And then there was a cardboard cutout of a mouse. Then there was like of a keyboard. And then you go to the kids and you say, this is what? See, monitor. This is what? And that's the computer science class. And I was baffled because I was like, wait, like, we're not only are we, like, we're in the stone ages. We're like literally so far behind where, and there was, you know, and just basically there were children in the class I was teaching that couldn't read or write. And this is like an SS1 class. You know, and so for me, I'm looking at. I think first, there's in every negative, there's an opportunity. I feel that like if we decided that we want to build an IT literate country, right? Because and people like in India, they do that. That's why they service the UK, like most of the call centers you call, because they developed ICT skills. And they know that, okay, we just build these mass call centers. We've given these people all the soft skills. They know how to navigate the software for specific jobs, right? And I feel like we can do things like that. I feel because of the fact that we're at ground zero, it presents an opportunity that we don't need to start at step 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 to climb up the ladder. We can just specifically say, this is where it's going. Step 20, okay, let's get a bunch of graduates. Let's teach them step 20.
Yeah.
Let them just learn that specifically. So we're able to offer those skills out. And then that begins to create an inflow here because they have jobs. You don't, a job does not necessarily mean that you have to go and like manually till the land every day, because that's not where the world is currently. Nigerians, we speak English, most people.
Which we shouldn't. So,
but no, but even as the fact that we do speak English, why, if you think about it logically, why, and I'm not trying to sound controversial, but I understand the clarity in Nigerians when they speak English to me than a lot of Indian people when they speak English to me. So why are call centers not set up here? Because they can understand, like we are able to communicate.
Yeah.
So it's to find people, communicate, train them and start like creating this thing. But we've already created a system of fear, first of all, with like people be like, we're not going to give details to Nigerians on the phone. You know, like there's, you know, so we have to start.
Terrible. And that is even spun.
We have to start. But then those things are deliberate. You see a country like Bali, for example, where everyone's going to Bali for a vacation, where there's a deliberate attempt from the government of that country to sell tourism.
For me, they're cultural mindsets that have been embedded at education level, mm-hmm. even before you get to that point, mm-hmm. In terms of critical thinking. Because mm-hmm. we have education systems that mean that people pass so much through cramming mm-hmm. their books. People are not understanding or having the foresight in their level of thinking that mm-hmm. means that they're able to make intuitive, innovative decisions mm-hmm. on the spot. Mm-hmm. And that is something that needs to be taught beyond mm-hmm. how to operate certain things on the computer, even mm-hmm. if you are able to do that. Mm. When you come into different issues or problems, mm-hmm. do they have problem-solving skills to mm. work out that stuff? Yeah. And I think that's embedded yeah. in different societies.
I agree with you. I agree with you completely. I feel that like the most critical factor to me, one, is education. Because the thing that we speak about and we say there's Nigerian doctors in the US and the UK or whatever, they are coming from a foundation of a, like now where, like I went to King's College, right? And King's College of my time, which is not that far from now, and King's College of now is like night and day. Yeah. So they're still coming from like another further 10, 15 years behind, which was still even better then. People are across West Africa used to come to Nigeria for different things, different specialties. They used to go to Nsukka for arts. They used to come to Lagos for nursing, healthcare, all of yeah. that. But all of those things have completely eroded, yeah. right?
How? And how did it get that way?
Because the truth is, again, using the same garden analogy, they were left untended for, it's been over like three decades. And it's a gradual...
By what? Why were they left unattended?
Because the funds, the truth of the matter is that the funds that were allocated to those things have not been reaching those things.
Exactly.
Yes. So what I'm saying is that now we're at a point where critically, right, we're going to stop even exporting the brain drain that we're pushing. We're going to lose that because we're not even training the children anymore. You know, so I feel like the first thing where we even, the first part is that the first opportunity, if you look at Nigeria, before you look at any mineral resource or we have to go and dig the land or whatever, the first opportunity is our numbers. Because the one thing that is going to continue exponentially growing is the population. And that is going to become critical if the population are one, uneducated, and two, are continuing to suffer. Yeah. If you are educated and you're suffering, at least there's a way out to your brain. You can, last, you leave Nigeria and go and stay in Benin Republic and set something up. Do you understand? Like, but even now, like there's now like a serious lack of like education. So we're not even going to be exporting people anymore.
Yeah.
Which is the only clear export that's working.
And Nigerians are some of the most intelligent people I've ever come across in my life.
Yeah.
Just the other day, I heard about some Nigerian girl in Texas breaking some records.
She's the youngest person to get into
16 years old. Her GPA was off. I've never seen anything like that in my life. Mm-hmm.